the wonder of sunset at evening, the wonder of sunrise I see, but the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is the wonder.
Good morning, my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. I really want to thank God for another opportunity that we have this morning to share from the Word of God, from the pot, from the ancient messages we used to know, or that may have been abandoned by the church today. The topic we are treating this morning, or we'll be looking at this morning, I want to believe it's not the kind of topic you hear every now and then. It's going to be a topic that might revolutionize our church and perhaps begin a process of causing revival to start coming into the life of Christians as well as the body of Christ as a whole. So this message, I believe that as we begin to review these things, the Lord will truly and deeply explain to us his mind in this topic. My prayer now is that may God grant you and I a better and clearer understanding of what this message has to tell us today.
Lift up Jesus, He is King of Kings. Lift up Jesus, He is Lord of Lords.
Shall we pray? And so, Father, King of Glory, I want to thank you for the opportunity this morning to be used to talk to myself and to talk to my fellow brothers and sisters who are listening to me all over the world. It wasn't easy, but I believe that King of Mercy, you have something in mind you want to remind us. There's something you want to help us to correct. There's something you want to lead us into knowing. And I'm begging you, please, do not just use me to talk these things. Also use me and correct me in areas I'm missing so that I can also do what you are asking me to tell these people to this morning to do. Then as well, please strengthen all my hearers and all my listeners this morning and give them the grace and the power to be able to do the same and even more from this day on. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Now, this topic we're going to look at this morning is, how can we do all things to the glory of God? How can we do all things to the glory of God? This is a very, very crucial topic. And then it's a question, very important question that comes before us this morning. Where does this one come from? Where did we get instruction that says we should do all things to the glory of God? It's there in the Bible. And that is what will take us to the following 2 points of reading, 2 scriptures we're going to read. The one is found in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 10, from verse 23 to verse 33. There are 11 verses there. Or rather 10 verses there. And then Luke chapter 17, verse number 1 and verse 2. From there, we will see what God wants to tell us this moment. Please, I want to pray that as we go down in this text, because we'll be taking this reading one by one as we are going, it is spreading the message along with itself. Therefore, I begin this particular way by saying, the Bible correctly, expressly, and totally told us or tells us to do all things to the glory of God. To do everything to the glory of God. But what does this actually mean? Does it mean that every small thing I am doing, or any big thing I want to do, let me say small thing like merely smiling, laughing, or big thing I want to do like building a house, or perhaps organizing a function, setting up something that will attract a lot of attention, that I should do all things to the glory of God? Is this not actually madness? How possible? How can we do this thing? Well, the answer is simple. Since the Bible says that all things must be done to the glory of God, the Bible truly means that everything should be done to the glory of God. That means such things like laughing, dressing, dancing, playing, buying and selling, singing, laughing, schooling, evangelizing, preaching, even to rest, even to lie down and sleep, even to eat our food, or whatever and whatever, just everything. The Bible says everything. Do you know, when we talk about everything, we have been talking about even going to bath. should be done to the glory of God. I know somebody is asking, which kind of thing is this? That is why I say messages of this nature are not available these days. And when the Bible says all things, it means all things. All I'm just saying is that may the Lord help us truly understand this message this day in the name of Jesus Christ. Now let us look at these things from this particular direction. Number one, what can we do? Or what can we do? Okay, the Bible, number one, let us look at this very particular point. Number one, if you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 10, from verse 23, go to verse 25 and verse 26. I'm going to read it. A paraphrase of what those three verses said is simply this. Please, you can do anything the way you like. But while you are doing it, have this at the back of your mind. Let's read that, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 23. I will read from verse King James Version. Verse 23 says, all things are lawful for me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but all things are edified not. Now verse 25, whatever is sold in the market, that it, asking no questions for conscience sake, for the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Please, let me read this thing from another translation that says, the contemporary English version. Look at the way they put it. Some of you say, we can do whatever we want to do, but I tell you that not everything may be good or helpful. Verse 25, however, when you buy meat in the market, go ahead and eat it. Keep your conscience clear by not asking where the meat came from. Now, the scripture says the earth and everything in it belongs to God. Permit me again to read from another translation like English Standard Version. It says something, all things are lawful, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. Verse 25, eat whatever is sold in the market, meat market, without raising any question on the ground of conscience. For the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. What is he saying? Brother, sister, you can do whatever you want to do. You can wear any kind of shirt you want to wear. Sister, you know we have been arguing some time ago whether you should wear trouser or not to wear trouser, whether you should leave your head open or not to leave it open, whether you should barb your hair or not to barb your hair, whether you should wear rings, jewelry, and heavy cosmetics or not to do them. The Bible says, from what is there, don't ask questions. As far as your conscience is clear, as far as you are comfortable with it, go ahead and do it. But there is a big but. And that is why we need to look at this. Yes, but what should guide whatever you do? Let us look at this. If you are doing this thing, my dear, something, do not ignore this in that same injunction found in this next three verses I'm going to read now. And that is verse 24. Then jump over to verse 27 to verse 29. Yes, four verses or five verses. Verse 27 to verse 29. Let's read it. I am reading the same thing from the same English Standard Version. All right. In fact, I will read it from easy to read version. It says in verse 24, try to do what is good for others, not just what is good for yourself. Are you getting that now? So if you want to wear a trouser, you want to do whatever you want to do, cut your hair, you want to go to the cinema, you want to watch any movie, you want to listen to any music, do whatever you want to do, not just for your own good, for your own self, because you like it. That is what your conscience loves. Do it with others in mind. Do you see that? The major thing is this. Do it for all with others in mind. What is others here involved? The conscience of others. I have not finished reading. The conscience of others is important. Let's look at verse 27. Someone who is not a believer might invite you to eat with them. If you want to go, feel free. Just like we talk about attending party. And do whatever you want to do. You can go to nightclub if that is your hunger. You can go and watch pornography and masturbate and do whatever you like to do. You call it evil. And I might even tell you that Christianity is in the mind, that Christianity is in the heart. Feel free to do it. He said, don't ask questions to see if it is something you think is wrong to eat or to do. Don't. However, verse 28 says, but if someone tells you the food was offered to idol, then don't eat. In other words, the place you are going is not good. You're not supposed to go there. Somebody tells you, this thing you are doing is not, sister, this thing, the way you dress, this the way you put on, this thing you are watching, this book you are reading, look at the place you are, look at the way you are even lying down, the way you are sleeping. The way, I remember a brother who saw me one certain time when we were in the university carrying a leather bag. Some of you can remember this cigarette bag that is called Benson and Hedges. And they used to have a leather bag and it had the design of that. And I put my books inside, innocently going along my way. I have been using that for a long time without knowing, considering how actually bad it is. But there was a boy, a brother, who saw me. We don't attend the same church. He saw me. He said, I knew you as a Christian. But brother, why are you helping the devil? I said, how? He said, look at the bag you are holding. It carries the advert of cigar. The more you move around with it, you are helping them to advertise this poison. My dear, I understood what he meant. I retrieved my books immediately and tore the bag. He said, if somebody tells you what you are trying to do, this thing that you know you are comfortable with, to you, it's nothing wrong. Christianity is in your heart, but it is nothing wrong. He said, to you, this thing, there's nothing bad about it. What is bad about what I'm doing? What is bad about keeping that boy as my boyfriend, girlfriend? What am I wrong about that? What about allowing myself to kiss him? What about allowing him to kiss me? How to kiss me? What about hugging? Romance, all those things. What about watching worldly music, listening to worldly these things? My dear, God says, please listen to the words of people. When they rebuke you, what the Bible says, if you feel you can do these things, and nobody will offend them with it, nothing is wrong. No problem. Go ahead and do it. And this is where I have problem with modern day church. They ignore the conscience of others. I have not finished reading. I'm still reading. He said, you know, the conscience of others. And they go ahead and do it. And some even say to hell, oh, but I don't care. What is it? Let them not be holy. Now let them not serve God. Let them not commit themselves. Dear listening, he says, if that person says, you know, that person said, he said, that's because some people think it is wrong. He said, because some people think it is wrong. And it may cause a problem for the person who told you that. Meaning the person may be discouraged. Person may begin to wonder, why did you do this? I respect you a lot. One of my daughters deleted me from her Facebook page, all right, some time ago. And then when she wedded, I saw the wedding, and I was through another brother too, friend too. And I tried to link her through her inbox and then find out why actually she removed me from there. She told me something, that she saw the way I used to use vulgar words on the internet when expressing my opinion on politics, abusing people here and there and using very, very harsh and terrible words. And then she even saw somebody who tried to correct me, and then I refused to even take the correction. Instead, I justified whatever I was saying. And for that, she said she knew how much she loved me, how much she valued me. She took me as her spiritual father and all that like that. But she cannot stand to see me using such faithful words. Since I cannot listen to such bigotry, she wondered how I would listen to her. And that was why, to avoid seeing those things I used to post online, she just quietly removed me from her Facebook. That statement cut me through, and I got the message right. One time I apologized to her. I even made a public apology on my Facebook wall to people, and a lot of them. People, I noticed really I've injured a lot of people. But before me, honestly, I have every reason to say yes. What I can say, I can defend myself everywhere. But somebody was offended. It caused problem. Did you hear what verse 28 say? Verse 28 say, caused problem for these people. It caused problem for the person who told you that. I don't mean that you think it is wrong. Yes, within you it is not wrong. That's what verse 29 says. But the other person might think it is wrong. Not that even might think. The other person feels it is wrong. You don't just need to do it. Sister, must you keep boys as your friend? a sinner as your friend, brother, must all these people be your friend? And the people who know you are wondering, why you even go to this place, enter this place? The other day, they saw you tasting alcohol. To you, there's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong. It's not bad. There's nothing wrong with you. But because of another person, who perhaps you might say is a baby in the Lord, please respect his babyhood. We are coming to the issue of baby in the Lord. God values everybody, and that thing is dangerous, can lead you to a very disastrous end. You can be, that's why many people go to heaven and be surprised to see how they'll be rejected, because they did not consider other people's conscience in everything that they do. All right? When we talk about things we do, can you see somebody, even the type of car you buy, that is one that you buy, it will throw up a kind of thought in people, and there's a house you build, people will begin to wonder how manage. They know your financial state. Ah, what happened? They want to know. And it begins to cause commotion in their head. People want to know, please. He says what? They think it's bad. That the only reason not to eat, that's the only reason not to eat. The only reason you should not participate in doing this thing, it is you now discipline yourself. You are not denying yourself what you know you should enjoy. But you are doing it. It's best now. It is discipline now. It is now discipline. You are now denying yourself for the sake of not being found guilty of leading another person to bear either grudge or bitterness or hatred against you. That person will go to hell, yes. You too, that is the cause of the stumbling block for that person, will also go to hell despite the fact that that thing you did was innocent. If nobody will be affected by what you have done or what you are doing, my dear, you are, go ahead and your conscience is clear about it. Go ahead and do it. And if you do it, if in that case, however, heaven decides to catch you somewhere, and God, if it's something you are doing and God has to actually condemn somewhere, he has condemned something, you go inside your house and do it quietly. Say, since nobody sees me here, I love to do this thing. My dear, if you continue that, don't worry, you are going to meet the devil. We now go shake hands somewhere. You hug him. We now go meet. You are going somewhere where the devil lives. Are you getting it? So when we talk about these things, therefore, the condition that should guide whatever we are doing, as stated in point one, that we can do anything we like to do. If you must do it, please bear other people's conscience in mind. Once you can bear that, then why do we pay attention to other people's conscience in mind? What is so important about that? Let us look at the book of Luke, chapter number 17, verse 1 and 2. We quoted this place before, and then at this moment, we're going to make reference to that, chapter 17, verse 1 and 2. Please look at this. Jesus said unto them, to his followers, things will surely happen that will make people to sin. But it will be very bad for anyone who makes this happen. If you are the person that makes another person to sin, it will be terrible. Look at it. It will be very bad for anyone who makes one of these little children to sin. Do you remember you called the other one baby child? If you let him not mature, this start thinking is for baby Christian. Yes, you who is mature Christian, take into account the baby Christians. Also, let my attitude help the baby ones to grow up to a level where they can see what you can no more see. And at that moment, he too might even do what you are doing, even more than that. But you who have understood will not know that, yes, he has matured now. He says, little ones to sin. What is that sin there? The moment they find fault with what they have, they may not commit sin thinking so, but it will put a grudge in them and they may start hating you. That can keep a malice. They can begin to think, look down on you spiritually everywhere. They will begin to see you from a different light you don't understand. And you don't know that you are the cause where that person is before God, a sinner. It would be better for them to have a milestone tied around their neck and be thrown in the sea. Meaning, wonderful. It were better. You see how people will go to hell. You see how people will be rejected in God's presence on the judgment day. That we are doing this and say, well, there's nothing, it doesn't matter. It is just innocent, nothing wrong about it. Does not exonerate us from the day that the judgment will come. That is why many good Christians will go to hell for not taking into account these little things. And I'm afraid many pastors today are leading many to hell with their own so-called liberation messages that give people liberty to do everything. And with this dangerous expression that Christianity is in the heart, the price of our sin has been paid by Jesus Christ. So nobody should come and be telling you about you being a sinner or that you are what, you are guilty of one sin or the other one. Now, how do we avoid being guilty? How do we avoid being guilty? Bible says here, do all that we do to the glory of God. In fact, the moment somebody patterns his mind to do everything to the glory of God, this thing we have been talking about will no more be a problem. I understand that in the modern day church, the glory of God means to do things, just service to God, this and that, getting busy for God, singing a song in a very, you know, glamorous environment with such alluring sights and wonderful musical artistic display and other things like that. Then we say the glory of God. Even some people know the Bible more than God himself, yet you can see that some of the things that they do visibly are horrible. And then at this moment we are saying two, do everything to the glory of God. Let's see verse 30 and verse to verse 33. Now, verse 30 to verse 33. The Bible reads there. Now, verse 30 of, the verse 30 of this Luke, is it Luke? We are talking about Romans, 1 Corinthians, verse 30. Let's look at verse 30, verse 30 of 1 Corinthians, chapter 10. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 30 to 33. The Bible has this to say, I eat the meat with thankfulness. So I don't want to be criticized because of something I thank God for. So I do whatever I do with happiness. I'm comfortable with it. And I thank God for giving the freedom to enjoy them. So you know that some girls feel more comfortable in jeans, short knickers, short dresses. But when you try to correct them that is not the correct thing to do, they will bring issues like weather, they will bring the Western lifestyle, they will bring the Chinese lifestyle, they will do different kind of war systems and try to use them to counter you and to confront you. Yes, before you are innocent, no problem. But then he said, if you eat, if you drink, do you see that the Bible is mentioning ordinary things like eating, drinking and sleeping, other things like that. In fact, if you do anything you want to do, do it for the glory of God, verse 31. Now, verse 32 says, never do anything that might make other people do wrong. Did you hear me? Whether the Jews or non-Jews, or anyone in God's church. I am reading from easy to read version now. Do not do anything that make anyone to see. You will injure yourself by ignoring this thing. Because I know many people will, because of their love for them, what they like. It means you are very selfish. You are just interested in your own happiness. We are interested, that is it. We are interested in our own happiness. For that reason, to hell with their own so-called conservative mindset. Hell with their own mind to thinking they care their own religion. Are you the only person who is more Christian than me? Holier than thou, Christians. If you think like that, you are on your own. I do the same thing. I try to please everyone in every way. I am not trying to do what is good for me. I am trying to do what is good for the most people so that they can be saved. Did you see what verse 33 says? In everything that we do, condition it to the salvation of mankind or for the growth of them that are already saved, towards becoming more like Jesus Christ. And that is very, very important. So the question I want to answer is, what does it mean to do the glory? What does to the glory of God actually mean? What it means is this. It means to design everything that we do to flow in such a manner that whoever sees what we are doing will have this first convicting impression or convincing impression that directs their mind to God and his beautiful ventures in the affairs of men. Whenever people see whatever you do, the way you are doing, the way you are dressed, the way you are talking, the first solid and convicting, in fact, rebuking impression they will have is, this is a child of God. This thing is of God. This is what Christianity is and supposed to be. Why not let us condition our mind like that? We need to do this thing. So let us look at some of the areas we need to be very careful to discipline ourselves enough. To discipline ourselves enough so that whatever we are doing, we should design it purely to bring glory to God. It brings glory to God only if people will have a feeling of God's presence around that thing. People's mind will be aroused to desire the things of God. People will have the prick in their heart that this is godly. People's mind will be turned to start condemning their sinful life. We begin to reject the things they are doing that are wrong. Once we are doing it that way, we are actually doing something to the glory of God. It's not creating a very beautiful atmosphere with such a beautiful and fantastic experience. No, that one, in fact, glory of God doesn't always exist in that kind of place. Doesn't stay there. There are a lot of flashy things there, a couple of things to distract somebody's mind from God. And that is that. Now, today, let's look at the areas that doing all things to the glory of God affect. Number one, entertainment. Show God in the ways which recreation. Our recreation should be designed in a way that when people see it, they will not see amusement. They won't just see entertainment. They won't say, these guys are catching groove. They will say these people are having fun. The first thing that they will have as impression that truly this is God. I wish I can enjoy more of this when I go to heaven. When you are singing music, people will feel the deep presence and convicting presence of God. Not the kind of talent you have, not the sweetness of the musical instrument, or the way you tune the thing, modulate the thing to now play on people's words, emotions. Yes, the sport, if you are going to participate in sport, my dear, make sure you know how to design this thing so that Satan will not be glorified. God will be glorified. People will see God through you. All right? I used to see some people who play football. Even though they have sanctioned that people should not be doing that anymore, but they used to do it before. Where somebody, the moment the person scores a goal, he will raise his inner shirt and you see to the glory of God. Some people even sing and thank God, begin to praise God. God worship you. Anytime you are discussing with them or interviewing them behind, in front of the camera, the way they speak, you will never know themselves. You will never see them talking about their abilities. No, they will ascribe everything to God. One person I always respect that does that a lot was Vincent, former Nigerian goalkeeper, Vincent Inyama. That man, every time you talk, you keep talking about God. You keep talking about God. He keeps talking about God. All right? I don't know. You may know some, but I don't know that this man I know of. All right, talent show. You know, we do a lot of things. They say talent hunt, whatever idol, whatever fashion. Look at this, they call Big Brother Niger. We all know that thing has nothing to do with God. I bet if you are going to show a reality show, if can you design a brother in the church, design in a manner that people, the moment they participate in it, my dear, heaven will harvest souls there. But if you know you cannot do that, please don't go there. Don't even sponsor, don't participate in it. Number two, business. We all know that in Nigeria, in the world's business, the interest of the owner of the business is the number one thing, not even the customers. Because of that, you see how prices can jump up and down. Please, in your business, be honest. Be fair with everybody. Be selfless. Truthful, it is, and the rest of them. Yes, a selfless businessman knows that if the normal price, he buys something at 100 naira, and then he will sell it. Yes, after taking stock of other things, for instance, and he discovered that at least by selling that 130 naira, he must have covered all the expenses involving transportation, shipment, and everything. Then he can add little for the sake of personal gain. And that is the kind of thing that must not be much. Please, the profit should not at least pass 50, reach 50%. So somebody can, it would be nice to sell that goods at 180 naira. It is wrong to sell the 100 naira goods at 500 naira. You are a thief. But we see it everywhere. People do business. There's a way you will transact with somebody. There's a way we transact with somebody. And people will come. Are you sure this thing is a real or fake? No, it's a normal fake. It's a real, genuine thing. This is because your pricing are so low and people don't understand. They go that place, they hear thousands. But when they come to it, it's hundreds. And they begin to wonder how. No, I'm okay. God is in charge. We know that the world is very selfish. Now, politics. See, we have to reject worldly politics. Worldly politics has one definition. Cover the wickedness, the fault of our own party member, no matter how wicked and dangerous it is, and then attack the opponent and cover his own good while attacking him with all his bad to make sure that he is demoralized, discouraged, and intimidated toward defeat. And then remove selfishness. Please, if you are going into politics, be clean. Let people know. Let people know. How many politicians came out from Nigerian politics, for instance, that their hands were not dirty? But somebody can enter there. There was a time we had one Senate president by the name of Mr. Pius Anim Pius. People talked about this man a lot. That I was told when the man's mom died, or either the dad died, you know, the whole presidency went to attend the burial at Ebonyi State. Our late daddy Osueke was there to preach. And after preaching, Obasanjo, who was then the president, approached our father and said, please, can you give us more people like Pius Anim to be in politics? Because that man has distinguished himself as a very honest man. Why not? We can have that. We can have that in church. So it's not about running away from politics. Me talking now, I don't go into politics. Do I make comments in politics? Especially after the entrance of the Buhari to government. I got attracted to politics. Under Jonathan and the rest of them that went before, I don't even have a time for politics. So we can look at that. Education. Please, what do we learn in this school? Is it to learn and come and begin to use it to attack and go attack God? Say Christianity is an insult, Christianity is fraud, Christianity is evil, or to learn it to improve upon ourselves and use it to really deal with the world with our so-called human intelligence and intellectual power. That one will learn. If I read engineering, I should know how to bend the teachings, what I've learned there, to glorify God. This is what the Bible is saying. We should do that. Fashion is another area that we must be very careful. Of course, you know that somebody said, apart from immorality, there is no other idol that people worship like fashion, especially women. We know fashion is a problem, and we are talking about it every now and then. Fashion, for God's sake, dress in the way that no other person will be offended. It's not even because the Bible says a man shall not wear what is a woman's, and a woman shall not wear what is a man, for whoever does these things is an abomination unto God. But for the conscience of others, stop it. Stop wearing trousers, sister. If you think wearing earring will make another person to be offended, and you are honest to be a child of God, stop it. If bobbing your hair will discourage another person, stop it. Why not? If there is wearing bun, whatever, long, bun straight or bun bent or bun short, whatever you like, call it, please stop it. I know you will not like it. It will pain you, but stop it for your eternal good. Yes, for the sake of another person. There are many who will be offended. Yes, I am sure that there are people who will be offended that are not. The offense doesn't mean anything. Seriously speaking, if you are doing what is right and somebody who loves carnal things begin to get angry with you, forget it. You don't have problem. God only knows that that person is a sinner, and what you are doing is making his or her own life uncomfortable. So that's why the person is hating you, because and might even attack and condemn you for what you are doing. Don't buy that one. It doesn't concern you. Go your own way. Lastly, we look at religion. Please, prosperity message you are preaching, does it bring God, people to God? If it is not reviving the heart of men to get close to God in intimate and mutual fellowship and relationship, but instead movement to love the mundane things here on earth, to become greedy and impatient people who pursue the God because of what he is giving and not because of God and his own ways alone, then your message is a poison. Please change now. Change. Stop this thing. Preach what the word of God says we should preach. And that way, God will bless our hearts. Now, let us look at this thing before we leave this place. Let's look at this thing before we leave this place. Now, how can we do all things to the glory of God? It's choice. It's your decision. It does not require you wasting a lot of energy, say you want to do. No, it's choice. You decide. I won't force you. I'm only talking to you, trying to reason with you. So it's your own, in your hand to listen, to decide. If you want to risk your eternal life, no problem. Please go ahead and continue what you're doing, no problem. But if you want God to accept you, and also God will use you, I don't have to be a preacher. After all, now that I'm preaching, I'm a teacher. I'm teaching, yet I'm a preacher. I'm not preaching the word of God. If I am to be an instrument, I don't have to be a preacher or an evangelist or whatever for God to use me. Even the way I dress is enough instrument in the hand of God to serve as a tutorial material to teach somebody and change somewhere without you knowing. You wouldn't know it. How many of us, we don't even know how many who will go to heaven only to reach there and hear millions of people who got born again by simply observing the way they kept their lives. They behaved themselves. They conducted themselves. And many were saved. And God will say, "Young man, yeah, I know you never go evangelism even once. But you see this 100 million, or rather 10,000 people, this is 5,000, this 20,000, this 300 souls down there. They came to this place now because of watching you. They came to this place by looking at you. You never talked with them, but they are your children. You brought them here. Can we please change? Judge yourself. Let us judge ourselves. Whatever we do, let's judge ourselves first. This is what I want to do now. Will it cause conflict? Will it bring argument? Liberate that, or I can let them argue, let them say whatever they want to say. That's their own business. My dear, whenever you speak that thing, it is yourself you're talking. Yourself is the one talking. Instead, let us do things in a manner that will bring glorification to God and help to save those who are struggling with sin, whether secret or open. Because there are things we do, we even encourage some people who are seeing themselves as sinners, but they are fighting to do better in the things of God. And when they see us, they now say, if this person can do like this, then it's better. I'm a better Christian. If I become an option to which a sinner encourages itself to become a more horrible sinner, then my ways, I am in trouble. Therefore, I want to say this day, let us not use our liberty and bring trouble for ourselves. However, let's just be very careful, like I said here. If we choose to do it in any other way, not by considering the conscience of other people or the glorification of God, but we choose to do it like gathering all the Bible verses we have and using it to judge whatever that happens around us, my dear, you end up becoming legal Christians. And you know those ones, their own is very worse. They live every day by judging, finding, they gather the whole Bible.
Who sing, angels are singing, praise the Lord.